All right. Okay, so in Shaduli, you had any exam in NPS and Prism? No exams. Oh, UT is going on, is it? Oh, 13 last UT, that's what you're saying. I thought 30th is the last UT. Okay, so still not many have joined in. I hope all of you are aware that the KVPY is postponed. Are you guys aware about that or not? KVPY is not on the coming Sunday. All right. All right, so I guess we can start now. Others will join meanwhile. Fine. So last session, what we did was we completed the chapter oscillations. Okay. All right, somebody is saying Olympiads also got postponed. Yeah, these Corona, God knows when it will get over. It is making our life tough. Okay. And most probably the Omicron will be gone in a month's time, and hopefully no other variant come. Otherwise, you know, maybe 12th also will become like 11th. Then it will be continuously 3 years. Okay. But anyways, so I hope all of you are vaccinated, right? Vaccination is done in the school nowadays. Not yet. Done. Tejasni is done. Siddharth is also done. Good. Get yourself vaccinated. All right. It is important for your own good. And then you can be a little bit relaxed about Corona. Anyways, so in the last session, we completed the chapter oscillations. Fine. So in the oscillations chapter, we had taken two sessions. All right. And now in the today's session, we are going to start the last chapter of physics, which is waves. Fine. So in your school, I think in NPS HSR, the syllabus is already over, right? And NPS Kormangla, what is going on? In NPS Kormangla, which chapter is going on? Okay. Shaduli, what do you mean by I think waves only? You don't attend the classes, is it? Okay, so oscillation is almost done. So it is waves only, which is happening in your school. So good that we are completely in sync with your school. And just that NPS HSR has run up a little faster. But most of the schools, they are doing this chapter called waves. All right. So now, first of all, we need to understand that this is a standalone topic or standalone chapter in grade 11, which is completely different from all the chapters which has come before this. Okay, because before this chapter waves, all the chapters were talking about study of matter, how the mass moves. What is the property of a matter? Okay, only these two things were focused. In thermodynamics also, thermal properties of matter only was there. Okay, in mechanics, it is all about how the mass is moving. Even the oscillation, the previous chapter to the waves, even there our focus was how mass is moving. This is the only chapter in grade 11 in which we do not talk about the movement of the mass as such. Okay, this is not mass, this is something else. Okay, this is waves. So everything in this world, in this universe, will either behave like a particle or a mass, or it can behave like a wave. Okay, we'll discuss what is a wave, but right now I'm just setting the context here. So have you heard about dual nature, duality, and stuff like that? Have you heard this phrase, dual nature of light and... Right? So dual nature means what? Dual nature means that the same thing can behave like a mass or a particle, and the same thing can behave like a wave. Okay, so depending on the situation, something can behave like a particle. Depending on the situation, same thing can behave like a wave also. Now, it may sound very strange to you on the face of it, but just look at yourself. For example, let's say you are with your parents. You behave in one way. When you are with your friends, you behave in another way, right? When you're happy, you behave in one way. When you're angry or sad, you behave in a different manner, right? So we humans have 100 types of behavior. Similarly, the matter also can behave at least two ways. Particle, way the particle is, and the way the waves is, fine? So what I'm trying to tell you is that wave and particle, they are two different universes in the physics. You can study the same thing as a particle, and same thing can be studied as a wave. Okay, in this chapter, we are going to exclusively focus on waves, the property of the waves, and how it is, how we can analyze the wave motion, okay, and understand how it moves, when it moves, what is the velocity of the wave, and stuff like that. Fine. So you can see in front of you, this is a wave. All right. There is a water body. On the water body, I have just put a stone, right? And the waves have been generated. All right. So first, let us try to understand what is a wave, and then our discussion can move forward. So write down. Waves. All right. So can you tell me, or let's say, what do you understand by waves? Can you tell me your understanding first? Don't worry about right or wrong. Try to tell me what is wave. Anyone, what is a wave? Okay. Good. Others? All right. Everyone? Aja, okay. You may not like to define what is a wave. Tell me some examples of the waves. Give me some examples that this is a wave, this is the wave, and stuff like that. Okay, I'll just write down one by one. Somebody is saying the sea wave, then ripples on the water, then sound waves. Okay, microwave. All right, so EM wave. Microwave is an EM wave. All right. Sun ray is again electromagnetic wave only. Fine. These are some of the waves. Radio wave is also electromagnetic wave. It is a electromagnetic wave. All right. Fine. So we will try to understand a little bit about the waves by taking an example of ripples on the water, because this is the only example where you can actually visualize better. You can't see the EM wave, you can't see the sound wave, sea wave, I mean, of course, you can visualize a little bit, but ripples on the water is the best possible one, which we can understand in greater detail to get a greater insight about the waves. All right. So this thing, the front page itself is the example of ripples on the water, right? So what has happened here? Something has happened or not? How you create a water ripple? Everyone, you might have thrown the stone over here. When you throw the stone, there will be some disturbance that has been created over here. Okay, when you throw the stone here, exactly at that moment, does the particle over here know anything about you throwing stone there? The particle has no idea that you have thrown stone at the center. But still, after some time, even this particle start some sort of movement. Right? You can see that the circle has reached here. Okay. So what is happening is that when you see the water ripple, you may feel like that the water is moving like this, and this thing is traveling. Some sort of disturbance is moving away from the disturbance. Fine. Now, have you seen Diwali lights in which, you know, a lot of lights are there, and these lights, they only do on and off. When the lights are doing on and off, you feel as if light is traveling from one place to the other place. Have you seen such kind of thing? Everyone? Right? So exactly that is happening over here. Do you think that the water is going this way? Do you think that water is traveling like this? Everyone, what do you think? Is water traveling like that? If water start traveling like this, if you throw a stone here, slowly entire water will just recede. Slowly and slowly, entire water will just go away. But that doesn't happen. So it is not that water is going forward. You feel as if water is moving forward, just like the Diwali lights. What water is doing is, what the water is doing is that it is only moving up and down. Okay. So these particles, which are there on this circle, So what happens is that these things, this entire particle on the circle, they'll together move up, they'll together go down. Okay. But one circle, when it moves up, other goes down. So like this, they continue and you feel as if the water is moving. But the reality is, it is not the water that is moving. It is the disturbance that is moving. Okay, the circular disturbance is spreading. Water is there only. Okay, so if somebody asks you, what is that something which is moving like this? That is not water. That is a disturbance. Of course, it is moving with the help of water. If water would not have been there, the disturbance would not have moved forward. So it is like, you know, when you travel, you're using vehicle, you're using car to travel. So similarly, the wave is using water to travel. All right. So I hope this thing is clear. All right. What is clear? That the wave is nothing but a disturbance that is created at one location and that travels from that location to another location. And in this case, it may use a medium. Shaduli, you note down the make your notes. Okay, we'll discuss it. Don't worry. It may use medium like water to move forward. Okay. And the wave uses medium to move forward, but the medium doesn't travel along the disturbance. It is not the medium that is traveling along the disturbance. Although medium is moving, it is not that the medium doesn't move at all. Look at this water. Water is moving up and down like this, but a wave is going like this. Disturbance is going perpendicular to the movement of the water. So I'm just saying that the water doesn't travel with the wave. Okay. So now, why are we studying this chapter? Once we are clear that what is a wave, then the next question that should come in your mind, that why we are studying it. The first answer to that is because it is in your curriculum and they are going to ask questions from it. But beyond that, if you ask that, okay, fine, that is okay that we are getting marks, but what else? The other very important aspect of the wave is that you cannot imagine your day-to-day life without waves. Okay, just look at the kind of examples that you have given. Someone has given example of microwave. So if you do not know anything about the waves, you cannot, you never can prepare, you can never create microwave. If you do not know about the waves, you cannot create antennas to catch the, any kind of information from the sky. Let's say you're catching the television signal. What is that? It is a wave only, isn't it? When you're sitting here attending the class, your laptop is catching the wave from the router. Router is emitting the radio waves. Your laptop catches the radio waves, and then only you are able to have internet and you're able to attend the class. All right. So like this, there are so many examples. Your mobile phone cannot run if we do not understand about the wave. Okay. And the primitive example, if you talk about like something which is like very, very important, the sound. Sound is a wave. Without knowing that sound is a wave, you cannot do anything with it. All right. So it is a very important aspect of our life that the wave is around us everywhere. Fine. So when I say wave is a disturbance, disturbance doesn't mean that it is something negative and you don't want it. Okay. Don't attach your emotions with it. Disturbance can be a very nice looking sign. Curve also. Disturbance simply means that something which was not there earlier, suddenly it has come up. Like water was like this, plain and simple. You thrown stone, you disturbed it. Okay. So disturbance can be something which is very important to us. Disturbance can carry energy in which there are information. All right. So what is Wi-Fi? Wi-Fi is having a lot of information about the internet, right? So that is what it is. So everything that is wireless, you cannot imagine without a wave. And that's the reason why it is there in our curriculum. Okay. So with a wave, you can transport energy from one place to another without moving the mass to that place. So it is a wireless means of transporting the energy. Okay, so the energy can be in any shape. It can be electrical energy, it can be magnetic energy. Okay, all right, so I hope things are clear. So now, once we are very clear about what is wave, how important it is, we need to now understand one thing, that wave is an ocean. Okay, what I mean to say is that wave has lot many details into it, and I hope all of you know that the electron has a dual nature, and when it comes to chemical bonding, the electron's wave natures matter more. Okay, because you are talking about orbitals, you're talking about hybridization. Hybridization is what? sp3 hybridization is what? The s wave is mixing up with p waves and creating sp3 orbitals or sp2 orbital and stuff like that. Okay, so that is the reason why we have already, you know, have accepted that the wave is there in every aspect of our life. All right, so there are different kinds of waves that are there, so it is better to classify them. For example, when you study the matter in chemistry or elements in chemistry, what is the first thing you do? You classify them, right? That, okay, there are metals, non-metal, group 1A, group 2A, 2B, 3A, 3B, like that. You create groups. That is called periodic table, right? Similarly, when we are studying, let's say, waves, we want to classify them, then only it makes sense to study them one by one, okay? And when we talk about classification itself, classification can be based out of anything, okay? Any logical thing. For example, let's say if I classify your classroom on basis of height, someone who is less than 5 feet 5 inch and more than 5 feet 5 inch, one type of classification. Another classification could be based on gender, male and female classification. Okay, so let us try to see what are the classification that can be done with the waves, which are logical. Okay, so first type of classification is classification based on how a wave travels. Okay. Wave that requires medium to move. Okay. Then there is this wave that doesn't require medium to move. All right, I think I have already discussed, the wave that doesn't require medium to move is electromagnetic waves, EM waves, like X-ray, sunlight, radio waves, and all those kind of electromagnetic radiations. They're all EM waves, okay? Then the wave that requires medium to travel, for example, sound wave, okay? They are the mechanical waves. Okay. So the mechanical waves, they require some sort of medium to travel. If medium is not present, they cannot move. Okay. So like I told you, sound requires medium to travel. right now, what is the medium between, like if I'm talking to someone, between me and that other person, the medium is air, the atmospheric air. All right. So when I speak, I create disturbance near my mouth. Okay. And that disturbance oscillates by using the air molecules, and that reaches the ears. If the air is not present, no matter what I do, you will not able to hear anything. I also may not be able to hear my own voice, because what is sound? Sound is disturbance through the air. Okay. And you might have heard about people changing the medium and their sound completely changing. Have you heard about someone inhaling helium gas and then speaking, stuff like that? Have you heard about such things? Right. I'll just show you. If you change the medium, then how the sound can change. Okay. I think I showed it to the last batch. William. Look at this. This is the ad.
Suck down a balloon and you'll sound like Daffy Duck every time.
I worked with a lot of wisecrackers, but you're despicable. Hocus pocus, splitty flam, rub the top and all the tail.
The helium isn't the only gas that changes the way to talk.
Okay. Oh, it sounds like one of those voice recorder things.
Oh my god.
Hey.
So what's going on here?
Okay, so you can see, I mean, many of you already know what I have just shown, that since it is about the medium when you speak, your sound depends on the medium. When you change the medium, you'll not recognize your own voice. All right. But if you want to try it your own, make sure you inhale the inert gas. Okay, don't inhale the reactive gases. All right. So next is classification. Based on how medium oscillates. Like I told you, taking the example of the water ripples, that the medium, what it is doing, it is moving up and down. So it is oscillating. Okay, so there can be classification based on that, how it is moving, medium. All right. And by the way, I forgot to mention here, that the study of EM wave will be done in grade 12. Good news. The bad news is that mechanical wave is there in grade 11. Okay. So in this chapter, our only focus is mechanical waves. But since we are talking about the waves for the first time, we are going to discuss basics about the waves, which is applicable everywhere. Even in the EM wave, that will be applicable. Okay. Only the basics. All right, so classification based on how the wave or how the medium oscillates. So this wave you can classify them as transverse wave, Have you heard of transverse and longitudinal ever before? It was there in grade 9th, right? I think, yes. Transverse and longitudinal. In the transverse wave, the medium is oscillating perpendicular to the velocity of the wave. Okay. In longitudinal, the medium is oscillating parallel to the velocity of the wave. So the best possible example of a longitudinal wave is sound. And transverse wave, like water ripple is there. The wave on a string is there. All right. I'll just show you one example of longitudinal, which you can see. Sound is a longitudinal wave, but you can't see the sound wave, right? So let me just show you. Look at this. Hope ad will not come.
Asan Bihar.
Look at this. This is the disturbance. This disturbance is moving forward. Okay. All right. So this is the longitudinal wave. You might be wondering that what is the use of this thing? I mean, this is just an example, just something so that you can notice that such, you know, that longitudinal wave exists. The longitudinal wave on Slinky may not be useful, but longitudinal wave as sound, once you understand how it works, you can see from your eyes, now you can study the sound waves in a better manner. So that is the idea, okay? So these are the classifications of the waves. Now coming to the chapter. In this chapter, what are the things that we are going to study? So let us talk about that also. Fine. So you know that in oscillations, we had what? On oscillation, we have divided the chapter like kinematics of the SHM or kinematics of the oscillations. Then we talked about the causes of the oscillation. Then we talked about the energy of the oscillation or non-ideal scenarios of the oscillations. Right? So something like that we can classify for this chapter also. So write down waves. Waves is slightly bigger chapter than the oscillation. See, I have come to know that many of the schools nowadays, they are skipping a lot of topics, at least in the grade 11th. Okay. So of course, that may be comfortable for you writing your school exams, but then that will affect you badly when you write the competitive exams. So make sure that even if, let's say, a topic is skipped in the school exams, so you study, when you study for the school exam, you don't study that, but don't skip that topic completely, okay? Because when it comes to an exam like JEE, KVPY or CET, BITSAT, VIT, whatever exam you write later on, all these things will come. Okay, they are not skipped from every exam just because they are skipped in your school exams. Fine. So the waves, you can classify it into four different sections. Okay, the first section is pretty obvious, kinematics of the SHM. Not SHM, I think I'm kinematics of the waves. Under this topic, we are just going to create some sort of mathematical formula for the wave, saying that this is the wave equation. And after that, we will analyze it. Okay, given this is the wave equation, what will be the wavelength, frequency, speed, and stuff like that. But we never will get into that, what is causing that speed from how the wave is getting generated. Okay, we are assuming that wave already exists, just like any other kinematics chapter. We are not getting into why this is happening. We are just assuming that this is happening. Let us study it like that. Okay, so the next thing is velocity of the wave. Now, the speed of the wave or velocity of the wave depends on the medium. Like, for example, when you travel in the car, it is the car that determines how fast you are moving. Simply here also, the medium determines how fast you are moving. Okay, so we are going to get into that, what are those properties of the medium that make sure that velocity of the wave is this much. And we will try to create some equations from which we can find out the velocity of the wave. Okay, then this section, the third section is a little bigger. Third section is the superposition of waves. So you must understand that when we were studying the mass, we had how many chapters? We had like kinematics, motion in 1D, motion in 2D, then laws of motion, work for energy, rigid body motion, okay, oscillation, so many chapters, gravitations. But entire study of the wave is done only in one chapter. Okay, so here you will learn everything in one chapter itself, fine, but not as much detailed manner as you have done the study of mass. Okay, but anyways, you will see many things are there in the single chapter. So in when we studied the mass, the particles, we also studied what will happen if, let's say, two masses will come and hit each other, collision happen, then what will come out of it. So we learned about the conservation of momentum and coefficient of restitution and all those things we have understood, and that is the way we have analyzed it. Now, under the superposition of the waves, exactly same thing is happening. One wave coming from here, another coming from here, they will meet. So once two waves have met, what will happen? You can't use conservation of momentum because mass is nothing. Mass is not there. It is just that one disturbance from here, another disturbance from here, they meet. So what happens to the disturbance? That is what we are going to find out. And unlike the mass, what happens after these two disturbances meet depends on how the wave was traveling before the disturbance have met. Okay, so there are three aspects. Okay, what will happen when the two waves that are traveling in the same direction meet? Traveling in same direction when they meet. What will happen when two waves, they travel in the opposite direction and meet? Okay, so this first and second, in these two cases, we assume one thing, that the frequency and wavelength are same. Okay. In the third aspect of this section, we are going to talk about what will happen when the two waves, they are traveling with different frequencies when they will meet. Okay. So that is what we are going to study. In the first case, I'll just quickly tell you, first case, you'll get another wave, which is traveling. Second case, you'll get standing wave. Third case, you'll get beats. Beats is a phenomena that you will see later on when we study. And the last part of the chapter talks about Doppler's effect. So I hope all of you were there. I mean, all of you were at some point in your life were there in the railway station. And have you ever observed that when train is approaching to you with a siren that is on, the sound of the train is, the sound of the siren is one type. And when it passes you and goes away from you, then the somehow the siren sound appears to have changed. Have you observed that or not? When train is approaching and it passes you, two different kind of noise you see from the siren or not? Right? So what happens is that when someone who is emitting this sound, be it train or anything, when that something is moving, then the person, let's say I am hearing that sound, then I will not hear the same frequency whatever the train is emitting, because train is moving while it is emitting that frequency. I'll feel some other frequency. So the frequency what I feel depends on how you are moving and in which direction you are moving. At the same time, the frequency also changes if train is stationary, but I start to move. Okay. So there is an apparent change in the frequency. And this thing is used by the radar and sonar. Okay. The radar and sonar, they are the two equipments that uses the Doppler's effect to find out the velocity and the direction of the movement of the enemy aircraft or whatever it is. Fine. So without the understanding of the waves, you cannot hope to create radar or sonar also. Fine. So this is the overall construct of the entire chapter. Now let us talk about the waves. Okay. Let us start the chapter waves. That is what I mean. Okay. First thing is what? Kinematics of the wave. Now, if I have to study kinematics of the wave, I need to know equation of the wave. Some sort of equation, right? You remember in oscillations, how we started the kinematics of the oscillation? We had observed something and we have created an equation of the oscillation, that A is equal to minus omega square x raised to power n. You remember that n belongs to odd integer, and when n is equal to 1, it is SHM equation. All right. So something like that we have to observe for the wave, come up with some sort of equation, and then only our study can start. God hasn't come and told us that, listen, this is the equation of the wave. We have to create equation of the wave, right? So let us observe few things about the wave, and then we can proceed. So let's say this is the wave. So what is this? it is a one-dimensional wave. This is a y-axis, this is the x-axis, and this is a disturbance that is going in that direction with certain velocity v. You can say that it is a string, wave on a string. So the string has taken this shape, and this is the wave, and this wave is moving forward. Okay, so this is how it is. All right. After time t, okay, this is at t equal to zero. After time t, the entire wave as it is will move forward. The disturbance has moved forward. So I hope you are getting this. The same disturbance. I am talking about the idealistic case. Of course, in real world, when the wave is moving forward, the amplitude will decrease and it will die down. But in ideal world, exactly as it is, the wave will move forward. This is, all of you understood or not? This is the wave at t equal to t. This is the wave at t equal to 0 seconds. Everyone type it. Is it clear? Okay. Now, if I have to tell you the equation of the wave, if I have to tell you the equation of wave, then I should tell you an equation. I should tell you one equation which will help you to find out the shape of the wave at any time, right? So how will you define the shape of the wave? You, if I tell you that I want, what is a y coordinate? If I ask you what is the shape of the wave, you should be able to tell me the y coordinate of any point which is located at a x coordinate x at a time t. If you can tell me a function of x and t, okay, what will be the y coordinate, where the particle will be, then you have already given the wave equation. Okay, so this is what we are trying to achieve. We are trying to find out what is that function, which is a function of x and t, that will give me the y coordinate. All right. And right now, I'm focusing only on the one dimensional wave. There can be many kinds of wave. For example, this one here, this wave is two dimensional. It is spreading in 2D. Okay, when I'm speaking, whatever I'm saying, it is spreading everywhere. It is going top, it is going front, it is going back and forth, everywhere it is going. So the sound is a three-dimensional wave. Similarly, when we have a string and we move it up and down, the wave that gets generated, it moves along the string in that straight line. So it is a one-dimensional wave. Okay, so just to keep my life simple, I am assuming one dimensional wave to study first. Okay. This is an example of 1D wave, like on a string, this is the wave that is moving. Now, will any function of x versus t will be the wave equation? The answer is no. It has to be some combination of x and t. Okay. Will only sinusoidal wave possible? No, the disturbance can be of any shape. Maybe this is the shape of the disturbance. This disturbance is moving forward like that. Is this sine function? No. Cosine function? No. It is some random thing that is moving forward. So disturbance can take any shape, need not be sinusoidal only. But yes, there has to be some combination of x and t. Let us try to crack that. So I'm going to show you something. Let's say if I tell you that this is the x coordinate of this point. This point's x comma t. Okay. This is the point, let's say point A. Can you tell me at t equal to t, its x coordinate is x, all right? at t equal to 0, what will be its x coordinate? What will be its x coordinate at t equal to 0? Anyone? The wave is traveling with velocity v. Every point has moved a distance of velocity into time. Okay. So what will be the what was the x coordinate of that point on the wave at t equal to 0? At t equal to t, its x coordinate was x. So don't you think that it was somewhere here, and this distance, this point which was here, let's say A dash, has traveled a distance of V into T. All of you agree? Type in. Entire wave has traveled V into T. Even this distance is V into T. From here to here, that distance is V into T. All the points have traveled V into T distance. Okay, so the x coordinate of this point at t equal to 0 was x minus Vt. Since it has traveled Vt distance forward, so if you take it backwards by Vt at t equal to 0, that was its location. Okay, so the y, which is a function of x, comma t. If I substitute x as x minus Vt, will I get the same y or not? This y coordinate will be same, right? So at t equal to 0, x coordinate was x minus Vt, t equal to 0. So the function x comma t should be a function of x minus Vt. Okay. So any mathematical function which is a function of x minus Vt is a wave equation. For example, if I say y is equal to e to the power x minus 2t divided by x minus 2t whole square, this is the function of x minus Vt. Velocity of the wave is 2. But if you write y is equal to e to the power x minus 2t divided by x cube, is this a function of x minus Vt or not? Second one. Is it a function of x minus Vt? Second one. It is not. There has to be x minus 2t in the denominator also. So it cannot be any function of x and t. It has to be a combination of x and t in such a manner that x minus Vt should appear together as a single variable. Fine. So when you make the coefficient of x as 1, the coefficient of t is the velocity of the wave. I hope this is clear to everyone. Anyone has any doubts? I'm discussing in a little bit more depth about the waves. These things are not discussed in the school or anywhere else. So, but then this you can understand. Okay. E to the power x minus Vt, I wrote. You can write anything. Right. So this is the wave. Here we assume that the wave is traveling in the positive x direction. If the wave is traveling in negative x direction, it will be a function of x plus Vt. Wave traveling in negative x direction. if it is x plus vt function. Okay, so this is the basic principle behind the equation of the wave, and luckily we have in our grade 11 curriculum only the sinusoidal wave in detail. Okay, so I am now going to shift our attention towards the sine wave equation, but you must be very sure that only sinusoidal wave need not be there. It can be taking any shape of the wave, need not be sinusoidal. So even this is a wave equation only. Okay, sinusoidal wave is a special form of the equation of the wave. That's it. So all of you, let us talk about sine wave equation. This will make your life a little simpler. All right. So what is sinusoidal wave? Sinusoidal wave is the wave that follows sine or cosine curve while moving. Okay. And in our textbook, they have assumed that this we can treat as a sine wave. A sine kx minus omega t plus phi. Okay, how it is different from the sine function of that SHM equation? You remember SHM equation was A sine omega t plus phi. In SHM equation, this kx term was not there. That is the only difference. Okay. All right. So this is the sine wave. And if this is a sine wave equation, can you tell me what is the velocity of the wave? To find out the velocity of the wave, you need to find out how it is a function of x minus vt. Try to tell me what is the velocity of the wave if sinusoidal wave equation is given in front of you. No one? No one? Make the coefficient of x as 1. The coefficient of t will be the velocity. So you can write it like this: A sine, take k common, will become x minus omega by kt plus phi. So you can see that it looks like a function of x minus vt, isn't it? So the velocity of the wave becomes omega by k. Is this clear to everyone? Okay, in this equation, A is referred as amplitude. Of the wave. Okay, and Sir, how did sine equation come? Sine equation, we are assuming. We are saying that let us study sine wave equation. It can be anything. Okay, even tan x minus omega t whole cube divided by cos cube x minus omega t. Even this is a wave equation. You can study anything. But we are choosing to study sine wave. Is it clear? It can be any function. As long as it is x minus vt is there. And you will understand one more thing soon. Let me first write down a few things. This kx minus omega t plus phi, this entire thing inside the sign, this is called as phase of the wave. The phase A is the amplitude, kx minus omega t plus phi is the phase. Okay. Now tell me, in this wave equation, if I put some value of x, let's say I'm just looking at what is happening at x equal to 5 meters. X is not a variable. I'm putting x as some number, 2 meters, 5 meters, whatever it is. Then does this equation becomes SHM equation or not? If this thing becomes a constant, if I put x equal to 2 meters, will it become SHM equation or not? Right? It becomes SHM equation. Because SHM equation is what? Omega t plus phi. So phi would be phi plus kx now. Nu phi. If x is a constant. If you're not changing x. All right. So that is one more reason why we are studying the sinusoidal wave, so that you can correlate with oscillations. All right. So let us study it a little bit more. All of you write down y is equal to a sine kx minus omega t plus phi. Okay. Now tell me, if you differentiate y with respect to time at a particular location of x, let's say x you're keeping fixed. Okay. What do you get? What is dy by dt? What do you think? Velocity of the wave is omega by k. So time derivative y is what? Who is moving in the y direction? Who is moving in the y direction? Wave is moving in the x direction. Along the y direction, what will move? Others, correct, the particles, they are moving. Okay, particles are moving in the y direction. So when you differentiate y with respect to time, you will get velocity of the particle. You will not get velocity of the wave. Velocity of the wave is omega by k. You already found that. So dy by dt is velocity of the particle. This is equal to minus of a omega cos of this. X I'm treating constant because I'm differentiating at a fixed location of x. Okay. So Vp is equal to, now look at this, a omega root over 1 minus sine square plus of omega root over a square. I'm taking a inside. test. So this thing is y square, right? That thing is y square. Y is a sine kx minus omega t. So the velocity of the particle is minus of omega root over a square minus y square. Now, does it remind you anything? What does it remind? Everyone, does it look familiar, this equation? Velocity of the form, velocity formula in SHM. It is a velocity formula in the SHM, right? Don't worry about the minus sign. It is just telling the direction, nothing else. Okay. So the particles are doing SHM. You can prove it like this also. So this is the SHM with y is equal to zero, the mean position. Okay, and the maximum possible velocity of the particle is at the mean position, which is y is equal to zero. That is omega times a. Fine. So now I think it is even more clear why we are studying the sinusoidal wave. So that whatever you have studied in the oscillation, you can use it again. Okay. Particles are moving up and down. They are doing simple harmonic motion. And the wave, sinusoidal wave, is traveling. Or in another manner, you can say that if particles are doing simple harmonic motion, then the wave is sinusoidal wave. Okay. Now, let me quickly talk about a few more things about this equation. Y is equal to a sine kx minus omega t plus phi, right? So when you're differentiating it with respect to time, keeping x constant, you get minus a omega cos of kx minus omega t plus phi. And when you're differentiating this with respect to x, keeping t constant means what? At a particular moment, you have taken a snapshot of the wave. You're not letting the wave change with the time. You've just taken a snap of the wave, which was like that. And that is like keeping t constant. And then you're differentiating that curve with respect to x. What you will get when you do it dy by dx, what you get for a curve? You get slope, all of you, right? Dy by dx is the slope at some location. So it will be ak cos of kx minus omega t plus phi. Here you kept x constant, there you kept t constant. So this is what velocity of the particle. This is what the slope. So when you divide it, you will get velocity of the particle divided by the slope at any moment. This is equal to minus of omega by k. Minus of omega by k is the velocity of the wave. So the velocity of the particle is equal to minus of slope times velocity of the wave. Okay. So this relation, if this relation holds good, it is a sinusoidal wave, and you can use this relation in maybe some graphical questions. For example, if I tell you that this is the sine wave, and if I tell you the velocity of the wave is 3 meters per second, and this particle, if you draw the tangent over here, this angle is phi. If I tell you that, and then if I ask you what is the velocity of that point P, that is the velocity of particle. So it will be simply equal to minus of 3 tan of phi. Tan of phi is the slope of this point, dy by dx. So like that, you can, you know, maybe if you encounter such numericals, you can do that. Fine. So what are we doing? We are just trying to understand this equation more and more. Okay. This is not part of theory. We are just discussing that, okay, this is a wave equation, then what all things we can keep in our mind when we solve numericals. So these are the few things. There are many more things. We'll discuss it. Let me show you one more thing. Let's say this is the wave. Okay, now this wave has moved forward like that. Okay, you need to tell me, I'll just mark few points here. Let me. So I'll mark few points over here. Point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. These are the points which are there on the wave at t equal to 0. T equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So after this wave has moved forward, the white line, the white curve became the yellow curve, right? So at t equal to t, it has moved forward in a yellow curve. If you tell me where are these points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, where are they? On the yellow line, a yellow curve, what happened to those points? Let me know once you're done. VT direction forward on the yellow curve. So are you telling me that this point is moving forward? Is this point moving forward? I think you are confusing with the previous example where I have told you this thing, right? Here I asked you what about the disturbance. You're not looking at the points of the medium. You're in this equation, the wave, you're just looking at the wave. This point on the wave, where it was over here, I am asking you about the particles, not the wave. Wave has moved forward. That is all fine. I am asking you that this point, let's say this is a string. On this string, the wave is there. Okay. Wave has moved forward, let's say like this. So are you saying that the points on the string, they are moving forward? No, right? It is not that all the points have moved forward. Now tell me, everyone. No one? Nobody else till now? Okay. So like what we discussed, the points are moving up and down, right? So point number one will come down. There is no other location. It has to be on the yellow line. Point number two goes up. Point number three goes up. Four goes down. Five goes down. Six moves up. So like that, they're moving. One comes here, one dash, two goes there, two dash, three reaches three dash, four goes four dash, five is five dash, six is six dash. So that is what points are doing. They're moving up and down. They make you feel as if wave is traveling forward. Is this clear to all of you? Type in quick. Okay, now tell me which are those two points which are moving similar. Similar kind of movement, where are you seeing? Actually, there is. There are two points which are similar to each other. Tell me, which are those two points? As this white wave moves forward, becomes yellow wave, there are two particles that are moving together. What are they? 1 and 5. Okay, somebody saying 1 and 5. Let's look at, this is 1, this is 5. Are you saying that they are moving similar way? Sorry, this is 1, that is 5. 1 has traveled this much distance in the same time. 5 has traveled a lot more distance. They are not similar. Correct. 2 and 6. Look at the 2 and 6. They are similar. 2 and 6 are similar. 1 is called crest or not? One is the crest. All of you agree? Crest of the wave. One. Right? So if I put a point over here, 7, the 7 will travel like 1. This will be 7 dash. Okay? So you can say that 1 and 7, 2 and 6. They are similar. Their movements are similar. Okay. When their movements are similar, we say that they are in phase. 1 and 7 in phase with each other. 2 and 6 in phase with each other. Okay. So, why I'm discussing all of this? Because I want to define something called as wavelength. Okay. In your grade 9, the wavelength was probably defined as distance between two consecutive crests or troughs, which is an incomplete definition. Okay. Why they made you remember something which is incomplete? Because they don't want to make things complex. All right. Because you take any two points on the crest, 1 and 7, they will move in the same manner. Okay. If you take two crests or two troughs, they will move in a similar manner. Okay. So wavelength is actually what? Wavelength is the minimum distance along the velocity of wave between the two points that are in phase, that are moving together. Okay. So 1 and 7, they are crest only. So they move in a similar manner. So distance between 1 and 7, you can call it as a wavelength. 1 and 7 is wavelength. And distance between 2 and 6 is also wavelength. It is the same distance. Okay. But then if you look at this point, which appears to be similar to 2 on the first look, but if you look at its movement, it actually goes down. 2 goes up and that point goes down. So this point is not in phase with 2. That is not the wavelength. You have to find out a point which is moving exactly like how 2 is moving. So that is in phase. Okay. So that is a definition of the wavelength. Clear? Okay. So we have defined the wavelength. Let us try to find out the value of the wavelength mathematically, how we can find it out. So y is equal to a sine kx minus omega t plus phi. This is the equation of the wave. And if wavelength is lambda, then if we put x as, if we substitute instead of x, x plus lambda, if we substitute that, will we get the same value of y or not? Everyone, will we get the same value of y or not? Right? We get the same value of y. So using that information, get the value of wavelength. What is the wavelength in terms of whatever is given? Anyone? Okay, so what we do, we substitute x as x plus lambda. Equate it to a sine of, because the value of y should be same. But if we equate it like this, we will get the value of lambda to be zero. Okay. So what we do is that we add 2 pi. That is the minimum time period of the sine function. Okay. Now when you equate these two, you'll get k times lambda to be equal to 2 pi. So from here, wavelength will be 2 pi by k. Okay, clear? So this is the wavelength. Now similarly, there is something called as time period of the oscillation. Okay, so you know that particles are performing the SHM with angular frequency omega, right? Every particle is moving up and down. So if you have to find out the time period, we know it will be equal to 2 pi by omega. Okay. And if you want to derive it, what you can do is that you can put the value of t to be equal to t plus capital T, exactly like same derivation, you'll get the time period as 2 pi by omega. Okay. And one thing you might have noticed here, lambda divided by time period is equal to omega by k, which is the velocity of the wave. And 1 by time period is frequency. So lambda into frequency is the velocity of the wave. So for every wave, lambda into frequency is the velocity of the wave only. That is the relation which you have learned in 9th also, right? Have you seen this relation before? In chemistry. Okay. All right. So enough of the analysis. Let us try to solve some of the questions. One by one, you can answer. First part, what is the answer? Pretty simple, 0.005. Second part, you don't need to do the calculation. You can directly tell the expression itself what is the correct. The wavelength is 2 pi by lambda. Lambda is coefficient of x. So pi by 40 meters. Time period of oscillation. What it is? Two pi by omega. Omega is 3. Frequency is 1 by time period, so 3 by 2 pi hertz. Fine. Now do the D part. Wavelength, the formula is 2 pi by lambda, right? Sorry, 2 pi by k is the formula. K is the coefficient of x. Do the D part, everyone. You just need to put the value of x and value of t. Okay. I think all of you are getting this thing, 0.005 sine of 36. Is this what everyone is getting? But what is the value of sine 36? Roughly what it is? 36 is in radians. Okay. And sine of 36, will it be equal to sine of 36 minus 2 pi? Yes or no? Two pi is a time period, so I can subtract it as many times as possible. Okay. So pi is 3.14, 2 pi is what? 6.28. So if I subtract the 2 pi 5 times, that is 36 minus 10 pi. So you will get sine of 36 minus 3.14, right? So 3.14. What is this? Sine of 4.6. Okay. Sine of 4.6 is nothing but sine of pi plus pi by 2. Pi is 3.14 and pi by 2 is 3.14 divided by 2. 1.5 something. So 4.6. So this is roughly equal to 1 only. The sine of 36 is 1. So the answer is minus of 0.005 itself. No, sine of pi plus pi by 2 is minus 1. This is plus 0.005. Is this clear to all of you? How did we get the value of sine 36? This is all mathematics here. Okay. They want you to do such mathematics in the school level questions itself. Okay. This is from your textbook 15.2. Clear to everyone? Shall I move ahead? Type in quick. All right. Let us take one more numerical. Tell me for this. So what is the answer? Can answer be A? Everyone, can it be A? Without calculating itself, you can reject A. How can you reject A? Why A cannot be the answer without you calculating anything? which direction the wave is traveling? Plus x direction, right? So is this wave traveling in the x direction? No. It is traveling in the negative x direction. This is also negative x direction. It is plus in between. It can be either C or D, right? In option C, omega is 12 pi and K is pi by 30. Right. So the velocity is equal to 12 pi divided by pi by 30. 360 meters per second. So C appears to be the correct option. So I hope the thought process is clear, how we have navigated our answer. Is this clear to all of you? Type in. How they calculate phi? Who calculated phi? How to calculate phi? Okay, so good question. Very good. This is the equation. V is 360 in the second option also, but there is a plus sign here. This is the wave that is traveling in the negative x direction. It is given that the wave is traveling in the positive x direction. In the fourth option, wavelength should be 60, right? Fourth option also, the velocity is 360 meters per second, but then yes, I missed one check also. Wavelength should be 60 meters. What is wavelength in terms of K? 2 pi by K. K is pi by 30 here. So it comes out to be 60. It will not come out to be 60 in this case. Okay. So we need to check for the wavelength also. Sorry about that. Clear now? All right, no, so somebody was asking what is phi. Phi depends on what is the value of y at x equal to 0 and t equal to 0. They should tell you some initial condition. Because when you're, you know, for example, let's say this is a wave that is traveling. Okay. Somebody say, okay, t equal to 0 is this. Somebody will start the watch little later by the time the wave has reached there. It's the same wave. Velocity is same, wavelength is same, frequency is same, everything is same. But your t equal to 0 and my t equal to 0 are different. So phi depends on that. At t equal to 0 and x equal to 0, what is y? That is how you find out. All right, so next topic. Next topic that we should be doing is the speed of the traveling wave. Wave is traveling, we need to find its speed so that we understand how fast our information is traveling. Have you ever, let's say, seen a movie in which some war movie where the enemy is approaching with horses and the other person is putting his or her ear on the ground to hear whether the enemy is approaching them or not? Seen those movies, right? Okay. So basically, why it is happening like that? Because It is a sound only. But sound travels through the air, or it can travel through the ground also. But when it travels through the ground, it travels a lot faster because the medium is such. So when you put your ears on the ground, you may be able to hear something which is happening very far at much earlier manner. Okay, so that's the reason why you have to do that. So when we talk about the speed of the traveling wave, like I told you earlier, the medium matters. Through which medium the sound is traveling, or through which medium the wave is traveling, and also what medium, how the medium is moving. It is all about medium. So how the medium is moving means whether the wave is transverse or longitudinal. Okay. So we are going to discuss it one by one. Like I told you, it depends on the medium, and also it depends on whether it is a transverse or longitudinal. Fine. So we need to be very specific about the velocity of the wave, as in different formulas will be there for different mediums, and different formulas will be there for whether it is transverse or longitudinal, because it depends on that, right? So we will take the example of transverse wave on a string. All right. So write down. So there is a full-fledged derivation of transverse wave on a string, how to find the velocity. We are not getting into the detailed derivation of the velocity of the wave, but whatever is there in our curriculum, in our textbook, they have done dimensional analysis to find out the expression of the velocity of the wave. So we are going to do that only. Okay. So every medium will have two properties. One is elastic property, other one is the inertial property. On those two property only, the speed of the wave depends upon. Okay. Now don't worry that it sounds a little weird. I mean, this derivation itself is assuming that you should know that it depends on inertial and elastic property. Okay. So you just need to, let's say, remember it. Okay, it is like you already know that velocity depends on inertia and elastic property, because the way we are deriving is not the true derivation. It is just like, say, I'll say that it is the proof of something which we know already, like that we are deriving it. Okay, so if it comes in your school exam, this is the way you have to write, the way I'm writing, okay? So transverse wave on a string, the speed depends on the inertial property, which is mass per unit length. This is mu, let's say. Okay, so inertial property has to do with mass. All right, now you can't say that inertial property of a medium is total mass of the string, because string can be like 1 kilometer long, 1 meter long, 5 meter long. So ultimately the same wave can travel on different lengths, right? So it is not the total mass that matters, it matters how the mass is distributed. Okay. So inertial property, you can take it as mass per unit length, and elastic property is represented by the tension. Now you'll say that, okay, why tension is an elastic property? The answer to that is, tension is like a stress that comes because of the strain. Okay, and strain means that the string has elasticity. Okay, all right. So if I say that the velocity of the string depends on mu and t. So I can say V is proportional to mu to the power A, t to the power B. Now, can you do dimensional analysis to find A and B? Try doing it yourself. Get the value of A and B. Anyone? Are you getting anything? All right, so I can see some of you got it. Good. So dimension of the velocity should be equal to dimension of mu to power A, dimension of tension to the power B. Okay, dimension of velocity is length t minus 1. This is equal to dimension of mu, which is mass per unit length. So ML minus 1 to the power A. Tension is force. Force is mass times acceleration. So this will be M to the power A plus B. L minus A plus B. T minus 2B. So when you correlate, minus 2b is equal to minus 1, so b comes out to be half coefficient of t. Coefficient of m should be 0, a plus b is 0, so b is half, so a should be minus half. And minus a plus b should be equal to 1. So you can see that when you put it over there, you get 1 only. Okay. so the velocity is proportional to mu to the power minus half t to the power half. And luckily or surprisingly, the proportionality constant is 1. So velocity is equal to under root t by mu. This is your textbook derivation of velocity of the wave. Dimensional analysis we have used here. Okay. So the velocity, the transverse wave on a string, the velocity of that will be under root t by mu on a string. All right. So let us take some numericals. Pretty simple. Try doing it. Done. Get a rough answer. Calculation might be a little tough. T is given to us directly, 60 newtons, right? And mu is mass per unit length, so total mass. All of you done like this only? But you don't want to calculate. So this is roughly 93 meters per second. Okay, good. So let me solve a couple of questions with you in which there is no calculations. So the excuse of not solving it because of calculation will go away. This is mass M. all right? Point A, point B. The distance between point A and B is L. All right? So we have created some sort of disturbance over here, and this disturbance is moving this way. Okay? The capital M is very large compared to mass of the rope. Mass per unit length is given as mu. Okay. The entire system is accelerating with acceleration A upwards. Okay. With acceleration A, this entire thing is in some lift. And this lift is accelerating with acceleration A upwards. We need to find time taken for a pulse to go from, let me name it as 1 and 2. From 1 to 2. Try solving it. Prashant got something, Sharduli got something, Siddharth got something. Everyone is getting something, something. Okay, can you tell me what is the tension? T is what? Look at this. Let's say T is a tension. Gravity force is mg. Acceleration is A upwards. Net force equal to mass m acceleration, right? So T minus mg is net force in the direction of acceleration. This is equal to m into A. It's under root T by mu. So mg plus A divided by mu. And time taken will be length divided by the velocity, which is this. This is the answer. Okay, so I can see many of you got it. Some of you might have done some silly error. Refer it. All right, so one last question before the break is this. Now, when you are using this formula under root t by mu as the velocity of the wave, although mu is mass per unit length of the rope, but many times we ignore the mass of the rope, right? But we need not be ignoring it, because that mass of the rope itself can create tension. For example, let's say a rope is hanging from the top like this. Imagine you yourself are hanging like that. You'll feel the tension or not? Similarly, a rope, when it is hanging like this, total mass is M distributed along, length is L. You need to find out this pulse, how much time it will take to reach the top. Okay? Try doing it. Step number one is, get tension as a function of x. What is x? You can imagine over here at a distance x from the bottom. What is the value of tension over there? Find out. Yeah, what you did not understand, Shadali? Which part of the problem? The rope is hanging vertically. What is there to understand over there? The rope is hanging under the gravity like this. Anybody got the value of tension as a function of x? Okay. So what we will do is that we will draw a free body diagram of this much. Until as you draw a free body diagram of that much, tension will not appear in the FBD, because it is an internal force. This is T. How much is the mass of this rope? What is the mass? This much portion of the rope. Total mass is capital M for a length L. So for a length X, the mass is M by L times X. That into G. Everything is at rest. So T minus mg is zero. So T is equal to m by L x g. Okay. So the velocity at any moment where tension is T is under root T by mu. Mu is m by L. So it comes out to be root over x g. This is the velocity. And you can see that velocity changes at every distance x. It is maximum at the top, where x is maximum and tension is also maximum. All right. Now we need to find time. How do you get time? Velocity is not constant. Otherwise, you could have done distance by velocity. So what you can do is that you can write velocity dx by dt. Yes, integration, your favorite topic. Do it like this. Dx by x integral is what? Everyone. What is dx by x integral? No one? Dx by root x integral, what it is? 2x dx. X to the power minus half dx, what is the integral? X raised to the power minus half plus 1 divided by minus half plus 1, 2 root x. 2L root GT. So from here, you will get time taken to be equal to 2 times root L by G. This is the answer. You want to take a break or should we continue? Break. All right. So let us take a break now. We will meet soon. All right, am I audible, everyone? Okay, so let us continue. We have studied till now about the transverse wave. So let us talk a little bit about the longitudinal waves also, because the sound wave is a very common example of a wave, and it happens to be a longitudinal wave. All right, so let's quickly discuss about it. So now, in case of transverse wave, we were tracking the y coordinate, right? Y coordinate was a sine kx minus omega t plus phi. Our transverse wave was like that. Fine. But in case of longitudinal wave, the problem is there is no y coordinate. Everything is happening on the x axis. Right, the particles are oscillating back and forth in the line of the velocity. They're going like this, they're oscillating like that. The y coordinate is zero. So how will we write the equation for the longitudinal wave? All right, so what we do is that in case of the transverse wave, what is the y coordinate? Y coordinate is a distance from the mean position. Similarly, here also, if distance from the mean position of any particle is, let's say, s, so we will track s and everything else remains the same. Okay, so make sure that you understand this thing, that ultimately the mathematical where the expression is exactly the same. So we don't need to study the kinematics of the longitudinal wave separately, because the equations are same. The kinematics of the longitudinal wave will be same as the kinematics of the transverse wave. Okay. All right. So we know that the sound is a longitudinal wave. And one more thing that is very common with the longitudinal wave is that the longitudinal wave is inside the medium. For example, when I'm speaking, the sound is inside the air. Okay. Another example is, let's say water is there. Okay. So on the surface of the water, transverse wave is possible. But inside the water, only longitudinal waves are possible. Fine. So usually, longitudinal waves are within or immersed inside a medium. Fine. Okay. Now we will try to establish some relation with velocity and the property of the medium for the longitudinal wave. All right. So in case of longitudinal wave, which is inside a medium, it depends on the elastic and the inertial property. So elastic property of the medium is represented by the bulk modulus. Okay. And the inertial property What do you think is the best representation of inertial property? If, let's say, the sound is traveling inside this room, inside the air. So what do you think is a best representation of the inertial property? Everyone. Correct. Others? Any other answer? Okay. Inertial property, in the case of string, it was mass per unit length. Right. Here, you can talk about density as the inertial property. Fine. The mass density, the volume density. Okay. Rho. The density. Now, do you guys remember the formula for the bulk modulus? It was there in the properties of the solid. What are the formula for the bulk modulus? Tell me. B is equal to what? No one remembers. B is equal to, correct. Delta P divided by the volumetric strain. Not pressure, extra pressure. Pressure is anyway there. The atmospheric pressure is there, right? Everywhere the atmospheric pressure is there. You need to create extra pressure to change the volume and things like that. This is a bulk modulus. In a differential form, you can write bulk modulus as this. The same thing. Okay. Now, if I tell you that the velocity depends on bulk modulus and the density, can you find out the value of A and B using dimensional analysis? Try doing it yourself. This is a derivation from your textbook. Anybody about to get the answer? Dimension of the velocity should be equal to dimension of the density to the power A to dimension of the bulk modulus to the power B. Dimension of the density is kg per meter cube. So M L minus 3 the power A. Bulk modulus, what is the dimension? Everyone, what is the dimension for the bulk modulus? Look at the formula for the bulk modulus. Delta V by V in the denominator is dimensionless. It has a dimension of the pressure only. Okay, pressure is what? Force per unit area, force is mass into acceleration divided by the area. So which is, just a second, the screen appears to have paused. Right. So M L minus 1 T minus 2 B. Tejasni got the answer already. M A plus B L minus 3A minus B and T to the power minus 2 B. Okay, now when you correlate this with that, you'll get minus 2b is equal to minus 1. So b is equal to half. A plus b should be 0. So a is equal to minus half. You can check here substituting whether you are getting 1 or not. You will get it. Okay. So the velocity is proportional to rho to the power minus half, b to the power half. And luckily and surprisingly, the constant of proportionality is 1. So velocity is equal to under root b by rho. But remember, you are using this formula only for the longitudinal wave, not for the transverse wave. Okay. Now, we have been taking example of a sound wave and telling that it is the longitudinal wave. Fine. So can we somehow get the velocity of the sound by using under root b by rho? Okay. So let's try to do that. So we know that density of the air is 1.29 kg per meter cube. Bulk modulus is minus of V dP by dV. This also you note down. The atmospheric pressure is 1.01 10 raised to the power 5 Pascal. So we want to basically find out that what will be the density of any longitudinal wave like sound wave in atmospheric pressure, which is this, having the density as that, right? So we know that the velocity formula is root over b by rho. But the problem is b looks to be a little bit weird in a way. The formula for b is this. So can we use this formula to find out what is the value of bulk modulus for the atmospheric gases? The answer is yes. But you need to assume few things. So Newton, what he suggested that, yeah, Newton was here also. So Newton assumed, that the travel of sound wave is an isothermal process. When sound wave that moves from one location to the other location, Newton assumed that it is an isothermal process, temperature remains constant. And if temperature remains constant, you can say that pressure into volume is a constant. Fine. So can you differentiate this expression with respect to volume and tell me what you get bulk modulus as? Everyone, try finding the bulk modulus. Take a derivative with respect to V and find out the bulk modulus. Okay, others? All right, so we can use a chain rule here. So P plus V dP by dV, derivative constant is zero. So from here, bulk modulus, which is minus of V dP by dV, is equal to the atmospheric pressure itself. Okay, so we can use this directly. We know the value of P. Is this clear to all of you? Type in. Does it make sense? Okay, so when it comes to the gas, the bulk modulus depends on the process. Which process it is? Whether it is isothermal, adiabatic, and stuff like that. So velocity comes out to be under root B by rho. B is pressure, the atmospheric pressure, which is this, divided by 1.29, which is the density, under root B by rho. And it comes out to be around 280 meter per second. And by the way, do you know actual velocity of sound in the air? Do you know how much it is? Any rough value you know? No, it is not 300 actually. It like, I do not know if you have seen it earlier. It is around 340, 330 like that. Fine, around 330 to 340. That is the speed of sound, and 280 is completely off the mark, right? So this derivation is not correct. So what Newton did or what Newton proposed was not correct. But the formula of under root B by rho was correct. So what Newton did was Newton assumed that it is isothermal process. This assumption is wrong. That it is an isothermal process. It is not isothermal process, because if there is, let's say, temperature difference between one location to the other, will the sound wait for temperature to become uniform, then sound will travel? No. Even if there is a temperature difference, sound will just travel through it. So it is not an isothermal process. What happens is that when sound travels, the other parts, they do not get time to exchange heat. So it's a rapid process. So if it is a rapid process, others do not get time to exchange heat. What do you think it is? What kind of process it is? It is isothermal or what? What could be the name of the process? Correct. Others? Right, it is an adiabatic process. So that is exactly what Laplace did. Laplace did some correction to what Newton had suggested. It is called Laplace correction. Okay. So what Laplace's argument was that the travel of sound wave is a rapid process. And no time to exchange heat. Hence, the process is closer to adiabatic. Got it? It is closer to adiabatic process. Fine. Now, for the adiabatic process, it is not PV that is constant. What is constant for adiabatic process? Everyone, do you remember? For adiabatic process, what I can say? Pressure and volume. Is there any such expression like for the isothermal, P into V is constant. For adiabatic, what is the process equation? Correct. We have PV raised to power gamma to be constant. It is not PV constant. PV raised to power gamma is constant. Now, can you find out what is the bulk modulus minus of V into dP by dV? How much it is? Everyone, find out. Anyone? What do you get bulk modulus as? Correct. Others, differentiate it with respect to the volume. Again, you'll get P gamma V to the power gamma minus 1 plus V to the power gamma into dP by dV. This is equal to 0. Fine. This will take away 1. Minus of V dP by dV comes out to be gamma times P. So the bulk modulus, what Newton suggested was equal to P, but Laplace came and told that bulk modulus is not P, it is gamma times P. Now what kind of gases the atmosphere has? It is monoatomic, diatomic, polyatomic. What is the majority of the gases? Diatomic, for diatomic, what is the value of gamma? Gamma is what for diatomic? Correct, 7 by 5. So factor of 7 by 5 was missing in what Newton did. So the velocity of the sound is under root B by rho, which is gamma P by rho. Now when you substitute the values, you will get around 331 meter per second, which is very close to the real value. All right. So this is how you take care of the longitudinal wave. And these derivations, whatever we have done, they are part of your school curriculum, very important for you. So make sure you understand them. All right. So right now, you know, we can actually do some numericals on finding the velocity, wherein I can give you the different values of pressure and density. So it'll look childish, right? The formula is there. You keep on substituting values and getting the answer for the velocities. So rather than that, let us move forward and take some more topics. And once other topics are over, then, you know, whatever we have learned till now, that will be anyway part of the numericals that we are going to take a little later. Fine. So let us move ahead. So the next topic that we are going to discuss is the principle of superposition of the wave. Fine. So here the principle of superposition says that if you have two waves, y is equal to f1 x comma t and y is equal to f2 x comma t. Let's say two functions are there, two waves are there. Superposition is a technical word of telling that two waves are colliding. Like two masses, they collide. We say collision has happened. When two waves they meet, we say superposition has happened. Okay. Otherwise, it is same as the collision only. So, what will happen when these two meet is addition of simple algebraic addition of these two functions, nothing else. Okay. For example, let's say I can say these two waves, sinusoidal wave, if you consider this plus this. This is what will happen. Now, exactly what will, this is what it is. Now, after this, it is mathematics, right? How you add them, you'll use sine A plus sine B or some other thing. You know, if you want to simplify it as a cos function, make it look like a single trigonometric function, whatever it is all mathematics beyond this, fine? So to keep the mathematics simple, we are going to take only two cases that is in our curriculum, fine? So the situation that we will be talking about is same frequency. I missed sign. Oh, okay. Here. Okay. So situation that we are going to talk about is same frequency, let's say omega, and same wavelength. Wavelength is 2 pi by k, so wavelength is same, k is also same. Okay, under this situation, only two cases we'll be taking. Case number one, where the amplitudes are equal. Case number two, where amplitudes are not equal. Okay, so let us take the simpler case first, where the amplitudes are equal. Anyone has any trouble, you can let me know immediately. So y1 is, let's say, a sine kx minus omega t, and y2 is a sine kx minus omega t plus phi. Okay. So you can see that phase of the first one is kx minus omega t, phase of the other one is kx minus omega t plus phi. So the value phi is referred as the difference in the phases, phase difference. Okay, that is the phase difference. So all of you, I want you to write y as equal to y1 plus y2, because guess what? These two waves are meeting each other. So what will happen after they meet? How will you simplify it? Write down. After this, what we will do? What kind of formula can we use? I want to see only one sine or cos function. What should I do after this? Can I further simplify? Can I do something with it? The answer is, of course, yes. How? Can I use sin A plus sin B formula? Yes or no? Correct. I can do that. I can take A common. So it becomes 2A. Sine of A plus B by 2, cos of A minus B by 2. So 2A cos phi by 2 sine of KX minus omega T plus phi by 2. How many of you got this? Right? So does it look like a wave equation to you? Does it look like a wave equation? Everyone, does it look like a wave equation? Yes or no? If you call this as an amplitude, now does it look like a wave equation? If this is the amplitude, right? It does look like a wave equation having the same wavelength, same frequency. So two waves, when they meet, they create a third wave. What is the condition? They both are traveling in the same direction. Kx minus omega t, Kx minus omega t. When two waves traveling in the same direction, when they meet, they create a third wave. All right. And whose amplitude is 2a cos of phi by 2. This is the amplitude. All right. Now tell me, what if amplitude becomes zero? What does it mean? It implies what? If amplitude becomes zero, what does it mean? Does a wave exist then? Does a wave exist? It doesn't exist. Wave is gone. Now, that is something which happens only with the waves. That two waves, they can meet and destroy each other. They both are gone. It doesn't happen with the mass, right? Like one mass coming from here, one mass coming from there, when they meet, it is not that mass is disappeared. But it can happen with the wave, because wave is not mass. So one wave that is like this can meet the other wave like that. When they meet, they become nothing. They destroy each other. That is called destructive interference. So can you tell me one value of phi for which destructive interference happens? Everyone, what should I put value of phi here so that amplitude becomes zero? Pi is one such value. Okay. What other? Can you think of any other value of phi? Pi is one value. Then another one. Can I put phi as 3 pi? 3 pi also give me zero or not? No, 2 pi will not give you zero. If you put phi as 2 pi by 2 is pi. So cos of pi is not zero. Any odd multiple of pi. Okay. So phi should be equal to 2n plus 1 pi for destructive interference. So if phase difference between first wave and the second wave is odd multiple of pi, when they meet, they destroy each other. Nothing will be remaining. Okay. And tell me one value of phi so that amplitude is maximum 2a. 2a or minus 2a, doesn't matter. Minus 2a just means that it is on the downside. What should be the one value of phi that you can think of? Phi is equal to zero. When you put phi is equal to zero, and when you put phi is equal to 2 pi, right? So any even multiple of pi, I'll say constructive interference. Okay. In destructive interference, amplitude is minimum, that is zero. In constructive interference, amplitude is maximum, that is 2a. Makes sense to everyone? Type in quick. All right. So this is case number one, where two waves that are not only traveling in the same direction, they have the same wavelength, same frequency, same amplitude, just that the phase difference phi is there. Okay. Now, why don't you see such thing happening in air? Light is a wave, right? So why don't two light, when they meet, they destroy each other? The answer to that is it does happen, but we can't see it if the frequency, wavelength, they don't match. If this omega and this omega, they are not same, the phase difference will depend on time. With time, within 1 second, 50 times at the same place, destructive interference happened and constructive interference happened. Our eyes can't see that. So phase difference between the two should not depend on time. The frequency should be same. Then only you'll be able to see destructive or constructive interference. Okay. I'll just give you one example. Have you ever gone, or have you ever passed through, let's say, a place where the oil is spilled on the water, and while you're walking through, you'll see that the oil on the surface of the water, sometimes it shines very bright and suddenly turns black complete. And then it shows you different colors, red color, green color, yellow color. Has it ever happened as you're walking past through it? No, you haven't seen that. Okay. So anyways, so we are going to discuss about constructive and destructive interference with respect to light in grade 12. You have wave optics that will have come in grade 12. There we'll discuss. Right now, this much is enough for constructive and destructive interference discussion in this case. The second case is when amplitudes are different, rest all are same. Case number two. Amplitudes are not equal. So let's say y1 is equal to a1 sine of kx minus omega t, and y2 is a2 sine of kx minus omega t plus phi. The phase difference is phi, but the amplitudes are not equal. So now mathematically you have to simplify it. What comes in your mind? I cannot use sin A plus sin B formula here because I can't take A common, A1 and A2 they are. Tell me one trick. How can I simplify it further? What comes in your mind? Tell me. Anyone? No one? Okay. So what we can do is we can expand it like sine A plus B. Then I can take sine kx minus omega t common. It is something like this. A1. It's mathematics, okay? Just trigonometry. Sine A cos B plus cos A sine B. So you can write it like that. A1 plus A2 cos of phi sine kx minus omega t plus A2 sine of phi cos of kx minus omega t. Okay, this is y. Now, after this, I put it here. You can write it like this, y is equal to A sine of kx minus omega t plus b cos of kx minus omega t, where a is this and b is that. So, wait. Now tell me, how can I further simplify this? You have done this in trigonometry in maths already. A cos theta plus B sin theta. How do you further simplify it to make a single trigonometric function? Remember that? A cos theta, B sin theta. No, you don't remember what you did. Do you remember multiplying and dividing by A square plus B square under root? Anyone? Type in. Have you done it in maths or not? Under trigonometry. Right, you have done it. This. Now, if I call this as cos of theta, what this becomes? What does this become if this is cos theta? Everyone. You can see that this is square plus that is square is 1. So if this is cos theta, this would be sine theta. That is the reason why we have done this. Multiplied and divided by root over A square plus B square. Okay. So sine theta is this, cos theta is this. So now this becomes sine A cos B plus cos A sine B, where tan of theta is B by A. B is a2 sine of phi by this. Does it look like something which you have done already? This expression, does it ring any bell? No? Okay, it'll soon. So y is equal to root over a square plus b square. This is sine a cos b, cos a sine b formula. So it will become sine of kx minus omega t plus theta. Okay? Right, Tejaswini got it. So now, is this a traveling wave equation? Is this a wave equation? Type in. Right, it is a wave equation. It is a wave equation. Amplitude is root over a square plus b square. Amplitude is root over a square plus b square. What was a? A was a1 plus a2. Let me just quickly check that. A2 cos of phi. B is a2 sine of phi. Like this. So it becomes root over a1 square plus a2 square cos square phi plus 2a1 a2 cos of phi plus a2 square sine square phi. Look at this plus that. You can take a2 square common. Sine square theta plus cos square theta is 1. So it will come out to be root over a1 square plus a2 square plus 2a1 a2 cos of phi. Does this ring any bell? Have you seen such expression before? Right, you have seen it. Cosine formula in vector. Exactly that way you have to find the amplitude. When two waves, when they meet having phase difference phi, they will add like vectors. The amplitude adds like a vector, as if the angle between a1, a2 is phi. So that way you can remember. Okay. So in school, you might have done the case in which amplitudes are equal when the two waves are meeting. But then this also you should be knowing, because in competitive exams, there's no limit. They can ask from anywhere. Okay. So if you can change the value of phi, what is the maximum value of amplitude that can happen in terms of a1, a2? Type in. It'll be a1 square plus a2 square plus 2a1 a2. That is a1 plus a2 whole square under root. So a1 plus a2. Minimum. What should be the value of cos of phi for amplitude to be minimum? Minus 1. So minus of this, it is mod of a1 minus a2. Okay. This is constructive. This is destructive interference. Fine. I hope it is clear to everyone. Type in. All right, so we have a good 12 to 13 minutes. We can solve some numericals. I'm not going to teach any theory now. Let us take a couple of numericals, okay? So let's say there are two waves, two sine kx minus omega t, and the second wave is 4 sine kx minus omega t plus pi by 3. Okay, these two waves, they superimpose, they meet. You have to find resultant amplitude. Find out. Prishim, Siddharth, got it? Others? Root over a square plus b square plus 2ab cos of pi by 3. Cos of pi by 3 is half. So this will be root over 4 plus 16, 20 plus 8, 28. 2 root 7. Okay. Next, you have y is equal to 4 sine of kx minus omega t, and y is equal to 10 times sine of kx minus omega t plus phi. These two waves are meeting. This phi can change. You have to find out what is the maximum possible amplitude when they meet, divided by what is the max minimum possible amplitude when they meet. What is the ratio for that? Correct. Pretty simple. Maximum possible amplitude is a plus b. Minimum is mod of a plus a minus b. So 10 minus 4. Amplitude negative means nothing. Okay. Amplitude will always be positive. Maximum, minimum. Minimum can be zero at the minimum value, but it cannot be negative. If amplitude turns out to be negative at any point in time when you calculate, just take a mod of it. Like 4 minus 10 was negative. Take a mod. 14 minus 6, 7 is to 3. Okay, pretty simple, straightforward. Numericals are pretty straightforward in this chapter, but the derivations are not so straightforward. Okay, so take it with a pinch of salt. Let me now, since we have what? We have a couple of minutes, we can take up some questions. I'll take questions from anywhere, okay? Now. I'll take this. Try this. Solve this question, everyone. You'll be much more confident if you, towards the end, you get some of the questions correct. Yeah, multiple options can be correct. Why not? Can be correct. All of you agree that T2 is equal to 3.2 G. That is 32 newtons, and T1 is equal to 3.2 G plus 3.2 G. How many of you got till here? Okay. I have skipped some of the steps to get this. Okay, but then you can draw free body diagram and get it easily. So I'm not getting there. The velocity in the first one is root over T by mu 1, 10 to the power minus 2. So that is 80 meter per second. That's correct. The first option is correct. Any other option? V2 is what? V2 is root over T2, 32 divided by mu 2, 8 into 10 to the power minus 3. So this is root over 4000. Right? Now root over 4000, is it 63? It is a 9, 3, 6 are 18. 36. No, it is not. But then if you look at somewhere, maybe in the internet or whatever it is, they may tell you that option C is also, sorry, option B is also correct. But then it doesn't appear. Okay, it has to be exact. Fine. And it may turn out to be exact if you take G as 9.8. All right. So let's not mark B as correct. It is only option one. Okay. Approximately it is 63 only, but not exactly. All right. How much time we have? Oh, 2 minutes. We can do one question. And here comes the question very, very quick. This one. Just one last question, everyone. Okay, Siddharth got something. Others? Anybody else? Okay, last minute. People are not awake completely. Omega is coefficient of t. So that is pi by 2 into 8, so 4 pi. And k is coefficient of x, that is pi by 16. All right. So the velocity is omega by k. All right. Don't worry about like, you know, that it should be x minus omega t and like that. What you can do is that you can convert this, take minus outside, it'll become like this, sine of pi by 2 x by 8 minus 8t. Okay, taking plus or minus here, it doesn't matter. It just means that at t equal to rather than starting like this, the wave is starting like that. It only means that, nothing else. Okay, so ignore minus sign. V is omega by k. Omega is 4 pi divided by k, pi by 16. So this is 64 centimeters per second. Is it clear to all of you? Type in. Quick. Clear? All right. So that's it from my side. We will meet next week. Bye for now.